Hi, everyone. Welcome back to another great interview series. My name is Mher. I'm from Vancouver, BC. And today I have the privilege to interview Gordon Tredgold from Leeds, Yorkshire. Hi, Gordon. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm great. Yourself?
I'm doing great. Thank you for being here. So Gordon is an international global guru, top 30 leadership expert and speaker. He is passionate about understanding why businesses and projects fail, and he helps companies, professional leaders, and entrepreneurs to help ensure they don't experience such failure themselves, and helps them apply the FAST model, which is focus, accountability, simplicity, and transparency to avoid failure and accelerate to success. Welcome, Gordon.
So, welcome.
Thank you for being here. So my first question for you as a leader and a guru, we know that we are kind of in a pandemic situation, and as a leader, we need to be adaptable and resilient. So what you have learned yourself during COVID-19, and what some of the conversation you had with other leaders in terms of how they led their teams?
So I've been very fortunate. I'd like to say it was planned, but it wasn't. I actually did a project for Fujitsu doing a data center migration. And that was a project that was the first time ever I led a virtual team, 100% virtual. Mm-hmm. So August of last year, my entire team of around 50 people, multi-million-dollar project, I never met any of them. It was all done online. So as we moved into COVID and everybody then started to have to move to virtual, I just spent 6 months doing that, and I'd been trying to understand what were the differences between leading in I've always been, the past 10, 15 years, there's always been some semi-virtual aspect to it because of the overseas team and doing things with Skype. But with 100%, it was different. So the things that I learned on that and was able to apply during COVID and share with other people is that when we are working in that virtual environment, leadership it's not different because leadership is leadership, but some aspects of it take on significantly more importance. And those aspects that take on more importance are the aspects of emotional intelligence, because we now have to engage people and keep them engaged when we have zero physical contact with them. Zero contact. So everything has to be done electronically and online. And one of my favorite management tools, and I love this, is management by walking around. But you can't do that in a virtual environment. So what you have to do is you have to find ways to do this. So what I found was that, I needed to organize more meetings. So I took an agile approach. We had daily stand-up meetings where we would just check in with everybody, figure out what they're doing, what's going on, keeping them informed, getting a little bit of feedback from them, and making sure that every single person, because they're not working with you now or within sight, so it's difficult to see what's going on, just double checking that they've got the tools that they need in order to be successful. Because on this call, as soon as you turn it off, I don't know whether you're having a difficulty or a problem or not. So we have to be, as leaders, we have to be much more proactive. We have to reach out and check. And the other thing that I found was a lot more important was making sure that when we did have meetings, quite often, you'll say, does anybody have any questions? And the usual suspects will put their hands up. And the usual suspects who never say a word just leave. And you've now got to proactively engage them. You have to say, hey, Bob, do you have any questions? What are your thoughts? Mary, you've been a bit quiet on this. I'd love to hear what you... So we have to be more engaging in order to get them engaged. And then the other thing I found is that the more recognition we give them, if we get them empowered, if we set them up, and then if we give them a lot more recognition, we that helps us. The engagement gets people engaged. The recognition keeps them engaged.
Yes, correct.
Because everybody wants to be successful. Yeah. Why would you stop something that you were successful at?
Yeah.
So that positive recognition. And that's one of the big things on the leading.
Mm-hmm.
Then the other thing that I've learned, and I'm not the only one, I think everybody has learned this. Those things that we said could never be done, we had to do. We had no choice. So I think once we start looking at disrupting our business, thinking about what's possible, what's not possible, with the experience we've just gone through, I think the bar on impossible has just lifted a little bit higher. And I've seen a lot of people be really flexible. My brother, he's, and I hate to say this to somebody who lives in Canada, he's a mountain guide in England. We don't really have any mountains, but he does a lot. He does a lot of hiking and takes people out on tours. So his business during COVID-19 died a death. So what he did was he had to think, well, how can I get people to do mountain climbing at home? So what he did was he went away and he calculated how many times you'd need to go up and down the stairs for the equivalent of counting Mont Blanc, Mount Everest. And he got all of the people involved in that. So, you know, it's forced people to get, you know, to be more creative, to be more disruptive.
Yes.
And I think it's given people a bigger sense of what's possible now. Correct. And I think a lot.
Yeah. And I also feel that some of the leaders who were resistant in terms of people working from home, or they didn't believe that people will work, I feel that now they can see that people can really work from home. Of course, the environment is different. You have maybe your family members, you have your pets with you, but they can work. Have they had any conversation about that with you?
So I have a slightly different take on that. I think I agree with you that we've proven it can work. And I think a lot of time people didn't want people to work from home because they didn't trust their own leadership skills.
Oh yes.
So now you're working away. I can't see you. I don't know what you're doing. I've never had a problem with that because I've always been somebody who'll go up and knock on a door and say, "Hey, how's it going? Show me what you're doing." Intrusive almost, but doing it from a supportive perspective, people appreciate it, and it takes a while to get used to it. But for those people who were command and control, who sat in their offices and waited for reports to come, it's a very difficult switch for them. And I think a lot of people didn't want to go to working from home because they didn't have the skills, the emotional intelligence. And I think now what's going to happen is they're not going to have the choice because people have shown I can work from home. You might need me to be in the office to do your job, but I don't need to be in the office to do my job. So I think the power dynamic has moved. The other thing as well, which is a problem with this, is that, you know, depending on who you are, you know, me, I'm married, I have three kids, but I'm an empty nester. So I have a spare bedroom where I can close the door and I can go and work. But if you're living in a smallish house with a wife and two or three kids, some people actually working from home, whilst it's technically possible and it's managerially possible, being at home where the kids are interrupting them and the dog's biting them because they've nowhere where they can shut the door isn't going to work. So we've got to make sure, find a right balance. And that could be that we have, you know, there's a place in, I think in London, I think it's called Workplace or something where you can go and do. So, you know, it might be that we move to these kind of shared, obviously not during COVID too much, but it, you know, if we want to move to that, we might want to move to these shared environments so that people still do get a little bit of interaction and they can have an environment where they can succeed. And I think that's going to be an interesting challenge because not everybody has the facilities to work from home. Short term, yes. Long term,
Yeah, and we have here in Vancouver, we have a lot of places called workplaces where people can come, and if they are entrepreneurs or if they are consultant, they can have their office and not be at home.
And then there's meeting rooms and coffee and there's conversation.
As if you are in a working environment, that helps.
Yeah, they're really good. It's like an open plan office.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's okay. Again, thank you, Gordon, for sharing your insight regarding COVID-19 situation. And for the audience watching for the first time, I'm going to ask Gordon a couple of questions, which will be posted on a daily basis. As if you are in a journey with us, you can check any of the videos, like and share, subscribe to the channel, reach to our social platforms, and see you next time for another question with Gordon.